So welcome to today's lecture. So today's topic is diode circuits, and within diode circuits I will basically discuss about the rectifiers and filters. So in the last day you have seen that there are different models for diode. More specifically, we have discussed about the ideal diode model. Then we have discussed the constant voltage model of diode, and obviously the practical diode model. Now for each of these cases, you have seen the corresponding advantages and disadvantages associated with that, and the implication of those diode models. Now in the same unit, that means in unit one, we will be discussing about the diode circuits, and there are different types of circuits where we can employ those diodes and we can achieve different performances. Now out of those different circuits, so today's topic is on rectifiers and filters. Now before I proceed further, let us see what are the applications of any diode. Now there are different applications, starting with the rectifier circuit. Then we have the limiting circuits or limiters or clippers. Then the clamping operation, regulation or regulators, and voltage doublers. Now each and every circuit is having their own area of application. Now today I'll be discussing about this rectifier circuits only. Now what does a rectifier do? In fact, whenever you supply the diode circuit with a continuously varying signal, for example a sinusoidal signal, a time varying signal, we know that this type of signal is known as an AC signal, that means alternating current. Now sometimes it is required to convert the signal, to convert the AC signal to a DC one. Application is the power supply. You have your power supply in the lab. Now to convert the signal from AC to DC, you require certain type of circuits, and these circuits are known as rectifier circuits. So our today's discussion is mainly on these rectifiers. Now there are two types of rectifiers broadly classified. One is known as the half wave rectifiers, and second one is known as the full wave rectifier. And within the full wave rectifier, there are two types of classification as far as the organization is concerned, as far as the architecture is concerned. One is known as the center tap full wave rectifier, and second one is known as the bridge rectifier. Now let us investigate each and every circuit one by one, and considering different types of models as well. So to start with half wave rectifier, we know that diode acts like a switch. So depending upon the potential between the anode and cathode terminal of any diode, the diode can be either on or off. So in the last class we have discussed that if the anode to cathode voltage, that is VAK, if this voltage is greater than zero for ideal diode, then the diode will conduct. And if VAK is less than zero, then the diode will not conduct. Now, if I consider constant voltage model, there you see that this VD on or on voltage of the diode is not equal to zero. Rather, you have some threshold value like 0.7 volt for silicon or 0.3 volt for germanium. Now, in order to ensure that a practical silicon diode will be on, you have to provide that this anode to cathode voltage must be greater than 0.7 volt or must be greater than VD on. Now here, initially we have started with an ideal diode model. So what happens is, suppose this diode circuit, I mean this diode and this resistor, this combination, this RL, this diode and this RL load resistance, this is connected in series with a sinusoidal signal. Sinusoidal signal is having a peak amplitude of say Vm. Now there are two different cycles. This one is known as the positive half cycle, T0 to T1, and T1 to T2 is known as the negative half cycle. Now I can always represent this waveform by means of Vm sine of omega naught t. Vm sine of omega naught t, where Vm is the peak amplitude and omega naught is the angular frequency. Now, what happens when the input signal is positive, that means between T0 to T1, you understand that the diode will be on. if I consider ideal diode, that whenever this Vin is just greater than zero, the diode will be on. And if the diode is on, assuming ideal diode, you expect that there is no voltage drop across the diode. It will act as an ideal switch. So therefore, whatever be the voltage you apply over here at the source side, the same voltage will be available at the load side. So diode will act as a bridge between the source and the load. So the output voltage is similar like the input voltage. So from T0 to T1, you have this Vm sin omega naught T. Now what happens in the negative half cycle? Now the negative half cycle starts from T1 to T2 during that period, T1 to T2. Negative half cycle, now during that time, what we find is, okay, let us consider this particular diagram, the second diagram, this one. During that time, what happens is, this anode potential of the diode is less than the cathode potential. So VAK, that potential is less than zero. So diode will not conduct during the negative half cycle. So as a matter of fact, if I supply a continuously varying signal, so you know that sinusoidal signal is the duration is infinite, periodic signal. So I can write V in is equal to Vm sine of omega naught T for all T, right? Then you find that during the positive half cycle, the diode will become on. And during the negative half cycle, during this time, from T1 to T2, the diode will become off. So as a matter of fact, you can get the output voltage, Vm sine omega naught T, that kind of thing, only during the positive half cycle. Now, if I want to represent the horizontal axis by means of this omega T, here it has been represented by means of T, like T0, T1, T2. If I want to represent in terms of omega naught T or omega T, then from 0 to pi, output will be there. Once again, from 2 pi to 3 pi, there will be output. Then 4 pi to 5 pi, you have output. And then 6 pi to 7 pi, you have output. On the other hand, from pi to 2 pi, the output is zero. Then 3 pi to 4 pi, output is zero. 5 pi to 6 pi, output is zero. So in other words, I can say that from 2k pi to 2k plus 1 pi, if I consider, or I can define another way also, that from n pi to n plus 1 pi, the output will be positive. And n is an even number. That is 0 pi to 1 pi. Once again, from 2 pi to 3 pi, then 4 pi to 5 pi, 6 pi to 7 pi. So in other words, I can say that from n pi to n plus 1 pi, when n is equal to even number, the diode will be on and the output is equal to the input. What happens during the negative half cycle? During the negative half cycle, the diode will become off. So only the one portion of the input signal will be replicated at the output side. So since this diode converts only the one part of the signal or one half of the signal, so it is known as a half-wave rectifier. Now the obvious question arises that is it not possible to get the negative half cycle to be present at the output side? Yes, it is obviously possible. So in that case, you have to just change the orientation of the diode. So here you have seen that the anode side is connected to the supply and the cathode side is connected to the load side. Now, if I just change the orientation of the diode, then the anode is connected to this supply, the load side, and the cathode is connected to the supply. So in that case, during the positive half cycle, the diode will act as an open circuit, and during the negative half cycle from T1 to T2, the output will be there. So depending upon the construction, the orientation of the diode or the connection of the diode, so you can have either positive half cycle or negative half cycle to be present at the output side. But you must not forget that this is not a DC signal. As far as your understanding goes, DC means a constant current. But here we are not getting a DC one. Rather, I can say that a unipolar kind of thing. The input signal V in is having a positive value as well as a negative value. Whereas this output, this out V out, is having a unipolar kind of thing. That means here the output is always positive I mean, output potential V out T at any T, it is always positive. And here the V output T is always negative. So it's a unipolar kind of thing. Sometimes it is known as pulsating DC. So since the half of the wave gets rectified, so this process is called a half wave rectification. Now, considering the analogy of half wave rectifier, is it not possible to design a full wave rectifier? Yes, it is very much possible. So for this purpose, you require two diodes to be connected. Now, this type of transformer is known as a center tap transformer, where this potential is connected to ground, and this potential is positive during the positive half cycle with respect to ground, and this potential is negative during the negative half cycle with respect to ground. Now, you have an input signal like this, V in is equal to Vm sine omega naught t, the same input signal. And if I assume that the turns ratio of the transformer is 1:1, so the same thing will be, I mean, the same input signal will be induced in the secondary winding as well. So since it's a center tap transformer, so you can expect that this potential is connected to ground, or this potential is having a ground potential. During the positive half cycle, with respect to ground, this point, diode D1, is connected to this point, and the anode of this particular diode D1 is having a positive voltage with respect to this ground potential. And during the negative half cycle, what happens? The anode of this diode D2 is having a positive potential with respect to this ground potential. So as a matter of fact, suppose the input is like Vm sine omega naught t, and if it is like 1:1 trans ratio, then output side you can have the same signal, Vm sine omega naught t. Now it's a center tap kind of thing. So Vm by 2 sine omega naught t here, and minus Vm by 2 sine omega naught t here. So during the positive half cycle, what you find is this diode D1 will be on, because this potential, this anode potential, is higher than the cathode is initially connected to ground, zero. So anode potential is more than the cathode potential because it is plus Vm sine omega naught t during the positive half cycle. So you have this kind of waveform, V out, flowing across this load. So you're collecting the output voltage across this load resistance, RL. Then during the negative half cycle, what happens? This potential becomes negative with respect to that potential. So during the negative half cycle, this potential, I mean, the potential at this point is higher as with respect to the potential at that point. So during the negative half cycle, D2 will conduct and the current will flow through the RL and in the same direction from this point to that point, same direction. So current direction being the same, so the output voltage, the polarity of the output voltage being the same. So in the positive half cycle, the current will flow like this through D1, RL, connected to ground. And during the negative half cycle, what happens? This is positive with respect to this point. So current will flow through diode D2, through RL, and to ground. So in positive half cycle, D1 will conduct, and during the negative half cycle, D2 will conduct. So now we find that both of these cycles, both of these half cycles, positive and the negative half cycles, they are rectified by means of this type of diagram. Now, if I compare the output voltage or the pattern of the output voltage between this half-wave rectifier and full-wave rectifier, and if I assume that the input signal is having a frequency of f, then you find that for half-wave rectifier, the output signal frequency and the input signal frequency being the same. However, for the full-wave rectifier, since you find that this kind of repetition occurs twice within the same time period, so here the frequency will be double. So if I supply this entire circuit by means of a 50 hertz line, so in that case, for half-wave rectifier, the output voltage will be having a frequency of 50 hertz, whereas for full-wave rectifier, you find that the output voltage will be having a frequency of 100 hertz, right? But this full-wave rectification operation is having some, I mean, using this center tap transformer is having some limitation that we have to encounter. What is that? This is known as the peak inverse voltage. Now, before going into the concept of peak inverse voltage, last day we have discussed what is meant by peak inverse voltage. This is nothing but
the maximum reverse voltage that diode can withstand. You know that diode being a switch, it can be on during VAK greater than zero and it can be off when VAK less than zero. Now during our discussion of VI characteristics of any diode, you have seen that there are basically three different segments. One is the positive cycle, one is the forward bias part, where the input signal, the VI characteristics looks like a exponential graph. Then you have the reverse region where VAK less than zero, then it is almost constant, the current is almost constant and negligibly small, minus IS, this is the magnitude of the current. And if you apply any signal, any voltage greater than the breakdown voltage, then what happens? Enormous amount of current will flow through the diode. So as a matter of fact, it is always advisable that you cannot operate the diode when the applied voltage is higher than the breakdown voltage. So although we say that being an ideal switch, it can withstand any amount of voltage during the reverse bias condition, but there is a specific limit that you cannot ignore. And that limit is known as the peak inverse voltage. For every diode, there is a specific peak inverse voltage. So here you find that during the, let me go back to the previous slide once again. Now here you find that during the positive half cycle, what is happening? This diode D1 is on. So obviously there is no drop across the diode. Ideally, there is no drop across the diode. But however, this diode D2 is reverse biased during the positive half cycle. So obviously some reverse voltage is imposed across the two terminals of the diode. Similarly, during the negative half cycle, D2 is on, so there is no drop. For an ideal diode, there is no drop. But for diode D1, since it is off, since it is under reverse bias, so obviously some negative voltage is imposed. Some reverse voltage is imposed across this diode D1. Now, each of these diodes is having some specific limit, some maximum prescribed value for this reverse bias voltage. And this voltage is known as the peak inverse voltage. Now, it is found that whenever you will use this center tap transformer for full wave rectification, then the peak inverse voltage being twice Vm. If I assume ideal diode, it will be twice Vm. However, if I use a bridge rectifier kind of thing, then the peak inverse voltage will become only Vm. So why it is so, I will be discussing later on. Now let us have a look at the bridge full wave rectifier, bridge full wave rectifier. Now here the center tap transformer is not needed. You have a simple transformer. Now there are four diodes, D1, D2, D3 and D4. There are four diodes connected in this particular bridge fashion. So obviously you may argue that using a center tap transformer, you require only two diodes to convert the signal from AC to DC or the rectification purpose. But here you require four diodes to achieve the same operation. Now, before going into the details of this, let us have a look how this particular bridge full wave rectifier circuit operates. Now, what happens during the positive half cycle? This potential, anode potential of diode D1, is more than the cathode potential because cathode is connected to ground. This point is, if there's no current initially, so this potential and that potential being the same, so this potential equal to zero potential, and here it is having greater than zero, so diode D1 will be on, but this potential is connected to the cathode of diode D3. Anode of diode D3 is connected to ground, so here this potential is greater than zero, and it makes diode D1 on and D3 off during the positive half cycle. Why D1 on? Because the anode potential is greater than the cathode potential for diode D1, but for diode D3, you find that the cathode potential here is greater than the anode potential. So D3 will be off, D1 will be on. So current will flow through RL. Now RL, although RL is connected in this fashion, you can always visualize that RL is connected between this point and that point, because these two potential being the same. This potential and this potential, this point and this point, the ground potential. So you can visualize that, okay, RL is connected between these two points. So what happens? The current will start flowing from this point, D1, then through RL. RL is connected between these two. And then what you find for D2, what you find, this anode potential is the ground potential. Whatever the cathode potential, during the positive half cycle, it is negative. So VAK is positive for diode D2. So D2 will be on. So the current will flow through D1, then through RL, and then through D2, and back to the loop. So D1, RL, D2, back to loop. So during the positive half cycle, fine. What happens during the negative half cycle? During the negative half cycle, this potential, this point is more positive with respect to that point. This point is more positive with respect to that point. So what happens? It makes diode D4 on because the anode potential is connected, anode terminal is connected to this point. So anode potential will be higher than the cathode potential for diode D4. Once again, RL is connected between this point to that point. You can visualize because these two points are the same, the ground potential. You can think that, okay, RL is connected in this point, between these two points. And then what about D3? For D3, you see that anode potential is at zero. Anode potential will be negative because during the negative half cycle, this is negative with respect to this point. So D3 will be on. So current will flow through D4, RL, D3, and back to the loop. So during the positive half cycle, the current will flow through D1, RL, D2. And during the negative half cycle, the current will flow through D4, RL, and D3. Okay. So what we find is we'll be having a rectified waveform, which looks something like that, full wave rectifier version, almost the same thing. And the current direction being the same from this point to that point in both of these two cycles, half cycles. During the positive half cycle also, current is flowing from this point to that point or this point to that point. And during the negative half cycle also, current will flow from this point to that point. So current direction is unipolar. So therefore, the current, I mean, it's always having a particular single polarity. It's not negative either. It's always positive. So once again, this particular rectifier, bridge rectifier, will give you the notion of rectification, a full wave rectification. But the thing is that here you find that the peak inverse voltage for each of the time being Vm. If my input signal is like Vm sine omega naught t, here you find that peak inverse voltage will be only Vm. Unlike your center tap full wave rectifier, where the peak inverse voltage was like twice Vm. So what is the advantage of having twice Vm? What is the advantage of having Vm with respect to twice Vm? That I'll be discussing later on. But remember that there is a significant difference between this full wave rectifier using center tap transformer and the full wave rectifier using bridge circuit. We have already identified almost three differences. First difference is that for full wave rectifier using center tap transformer, you require a center tap transformer. However, for a full wave rectifier involving bridge circuit, you don't require this center tap transformer. Normal transformer will do the purpose. Second thing is that for half wave rectifier, for full wave rectifier using your center tap transformer, you require only two diodes. However, for full wave rectifiers involving bridge, you require four diodes for the complete operation. And thirdly, this is from the architectural point of view, and from the functional point of view, you have at this particular moment, I have already mentioned only one difference in terms of functional point of view. The difference is that the peak inverse voltage for the diodes operated in center tap mode is having a value of twice Vm, where Vm sin omega t is input signal. However, the peak inverse voltage for the diodes operated under bridge configuration, it is having a value of Vm. There are still some other differences that I will mention one by one. And that will occur for the practical diode, not for the ideal diode. For ideal diode, only these two or three differences you can point out. Okay, so now let us compare the parameters. So there are some mathematics. So I did not compute the mathematics, but I can tell you how to calculate all these things. One is the DC output. So what do you mean by the DC output? Whenever you find an input signal, it's like Vm sine omega naught t, you know that how to find out the DC value of that. It is nothing but the average. And since this signal is a continuously varying signal, continuously varying time signal, so you can always find out the average by using the integration formula, because we have to apply integration. It's not summation, because a continuous signal, integration you have to apply. And the sinusoidal signal, you know, is a periodic signal. So you can compute this averaging operation over a single period only. So the period becomes a like capital T, the time duration. I mean, the time duration is capital T. So how to find out the DC value, VDC? This is nothing but integration over 0 to capital T Vm sin omega t. Integration over 0 to capital T Vm sin omega t dt. And this is the overall one. And you have to divide it by 1 by t so that you can get the average. So 1 by t, integration 0 to capital T Vm sin omega t dt. So if you compute this one, you will find that the average value is coming like 0. which is quite obvious, because for any sinusoidal signal, once again, if I go back to this circuit, so here this is a sinusoidal signal. So how to find out the average? This is nothing but the area under the curve. So here you find that the area contained by the positive half cycle and the area contained by the negative half cycle being the same. As far as the magnitude is concerned, they are the same. So therefore, the average value of any sinusoidal signal, as you know, pure sinusoidal signal, Vm sin omega naught t kind of thing. So average value will be equal to zero, right? The DC value, which is nothing but this line, the DC value. However, the DC value will not be zero for the rectified output. For example, if I consider this output, here you see that the DC value, the average value is not zero. There is some non-zero positive average value. Similarly, for full wave rectifier also, it's a non-zero average value, non-zero DC value is there. But you must appreciate that for a full wave rectifier output, the DC value will be double as compared to that of the half wave rectifier. Because for half wave rectifier, within a single cycle of the input signal, you have only one such variation, Vm sin omega t. However, for full wave rectifier, you have two such variations within the single period. So if I compute the average value of the output signal, it will be obviously double as compared to the half wave rectifier output. So there are another mechanism to calculate the DC value or the average value. This can be computed by means of the integration is carried out with respect to omega t. That means instead of integrating over from 0 to capital T, what you can do is you can integrate over 0 to 2 pi, because 2 pi is the duration of this, with respect to omega t, this is the period of the sinusoidal signal. So what you can do is 1 by 2 pi, integration 0 to 2 pi, Vm sin omega t, and then d omega t, because the variable here is omega t. So there are two options, either you integrate with respect to t, or you integrate with respect to omega t. So if you integrate with respect to t, then it will be like 0 to t Vm sin omega t dt. T is the variable, and you have to divide by 1 by t, 1 by capital T. And if you want to integrate with respect to omega t, then it will be like Vm sin omega t d omega t, and the integration from 0 to 2 pi, and it will be having a factor 1 by 2 pi outside, just like this. So this is the scenario for your input signal. Now what happens for the rectified output signal? You have the same thing. You can write the same expression. So V DC or V average equal to 1 by 2 pi integration over 0 to 2 pi V out T and D of omega T. Now if you observe V out T, so V out T for half wave rectifier, I cannot write simple Vm sin omega T for 0 to 2 pi. Rather, it will be having Vm sin omega T from 0 to pi only. So the average value computation will be something like that, 1 by 2 pi integration over 0 to pi Vm sin omega t d omega t, right? And for the full wave rectifier, you find that the same thing is repeated twice. So what you can write is 1 by 2 pi integration 0 to pi Vm sin omega t d omega t multiplied with 2. So ultimately, you have this DC output like Vm by pi for half wave rectifier and 2 Vm by pi for full wave rectifier. It is like 0.318 Vm and 0.636 Vm for half wave and full wave rectifier output respectively. There is another concept apart from this DC value. DC value will give you the average component present in the signal, average value present in the signal. There is another component known as the RMS output. The RMS. RMS stands for root mean square. Now, if I have a sinusoidal signal, you have seen that the DC value is equal to 0 volt, the average value equal to 0 volt. But there will be some non-zero RMS value, a root mean square value. How to calculate the RMS value? In order to calculate the RMS value, you just follow the notation root mean square. So first of all, you have to square the individual component, Vm sin omega t. If this is the input signal, Vm sin omega t, you have to make it square. So Vm sin omega t whole square, then mean square. So how to find out the mean? You just calculate this for all such t. So integration of our 0 to 2 pi Vm sin omega t whole square d omega t. Then 1 by 2 pi, that will be the averaging operation, and square root of that. So in that way, you can find out the RMS output. So if you do some calculation, you can find that for half wave rectifier, the RMS value is like 0.5 Vm, and RMS output will be 0.707 Vm, which is nothing but Vm by root 2 for full wave rectifier output. And perhaps you know that for a pure sinusoidal signal, the average value equal to 0, and the RMS value is nothing but Vm by root 2 only. So the RMS output for full wave rectifier signal and the RMS output for a pure sinusoidal signal being the same, because you have found out the square only. That means if I consider this diagram, so RMS of this waveform, RMS of this input waveform, and RMS of this waveform being the same, because whenever you make any attempt to find out the square, so this negative thing will become positive. So squaring this signal and squaring this signal is having no difference. So in that way, you can find out the RMS output. Now, from this DC value and the RMS value, you can estimate the smoothness of the signal, whether the signal is smooth or not. So the smoothness can be obtained from a factor which is known as a form factor. So form factor is defined by the VRMS value divided by the V average value. So here average and DC being the same, VRMS by V average is known as the form factor, and which tells you about the smoothness of the signal, the output signal that you have got. So if you just put those values, you'll find that the form factor will become like 157% or 1.57 for half wave rectifier, and the full wave rectifier, it will be a little bit more smoother. So in that case, it will be like 111% or 1.11, the form factor. Now there are other factors as well. One is known as the AC ripple output. So what is that AC ripple output? As I've already told you, the output signal is a pulsating DC. So you have this kind of waveform, full wave rectifier output, this kind of waveform. So there is a particular DC line, like 2 Vm by pi, which you have seen that 0.636 Vm. So this is the DC output. Now over and above this DC output, you have some AC variation. So overall output here for half wave or for full wave is having two defined components. One component is the average component. There is some average value plus some alternating component. For example, in your examination also, suppose for any particular subject, suppose the marks varies from say 50 to say 90, the variation of marks within a particular class is varying from 50 to 90. So sometimes we are interested in finding out what is the average value of the marks, or what is the average percentage of marks obtained by the students in that particular course. So what we can do is we just calculate the number obtained by each of the students. Suppose there are 50 students, you just calculate all the numbers, 55, 73, 92, 83, just like this, you just add on them and divide by the total number of students. So you can have some idea regarding the average value. Like, suppose the average value equal to say 72. This is the average. Now, so 72 is the baseline. Now, over and above this 72, there is some perturbation, there is some variation. Some student has got like 81, so 72 plus 9. Some student has got like 53, so 72 minus 19. So I can say that each and every student is having a baseline, a base average value like 72. And if the performance is better for the student, then the alternating component is positive for him, like 72 plus 9 becomes 81. And if the performance is less than the average performance, that can be identified by a negative component. So 72 minus of this 19, so 53. So in this way, each and every student, although they are getting some number, absolute number, like 63, 49, 39, 52, 58, they are getting some absolute number, but I can always visualize this absolute number is having two defined components. One component is the average value that you can compute for the whole class, and suppose the value is like 72, and you add some alternating component with that, like 72 plus 3, 72 plus 9, 72 minus 3, 72 minus 5, 72 minus 18, 72 plus 7, like this. Now this plus 3 minus 7 plus 18 minus 19, this is known as the AC component of the signal, or the alternating component of the signal. So each and every student is having some base value, the average value like 72, plus some alternating component, plus 13 minus 12 plus 18 minus 19 plus 16 plus 13, just like this. So this is known as AC component or alternating component. So for this alternating component also, you can find out what is the ripple. What is the ripple called? What is the RMS value of this alternating component? What is the RMS value of this alternating component? You can find it out. So the same analogy can also be applied over here when you are finding out this AC ripple output. So VR RMS, this is the ripple of the AC component, not the overall signal, rather ripple on the AC component. So for half wave rectifier, you understand that ripple will be much higher as compared to the full wave because there is a repetition, and the smoothness will be higher for full wave rectifier. And this ripple component or this from this AC ripple output, you can calculate another factor, which is known as the ripple factor, which is nothing but the ratio of two different terms. One is known as the VR RMS or this AC ripple output divided by the VDC or the average value. It's like 121% for your half-wave rectifier output, and it is like 48% for this full-wave rectifier output. So you understand that the ripple component is less, or the variation or the fluctuation is less for full-wave rectifier. Why? Because for half-wave rectifier, you have one signal like this at from 0 to pi. Then you have another signal, another same signal from 2 pi to 3 pi. Then another another Vm sin omega t from 4 pi to 5 pi. Then at 6 pi to 7 pi. So there is some variation. There is some ripple component present. Whereas in case of full wave rectifier, you'll see that 0 to pi, the waveform is present. Then the same waveform is also present from pi to 2 pi. So here the fluctuation is less as compared to this one. And PIV, as I've already mentioned, it is like Vm for half-wave rectifier, and it is like twice Vm for full-wave rectifier. How it is twice Vm? I'm coming to that. Before that, let us appreciate that PIV, VPIV is equal to Vm for half-wave rectifier. So for that, once again, let's go back to the half-wave circuit. Now, what is happening? So we have to calculate this PIV when the diode is off. So here we find that this diode is off during the negative half cycle. Okay. So what happens? During the negative half cycle, this potential is less as compared to this potential. So diode becomes off. So what is the maximum voltage? So here you find that during the negative half cycle, output is zero. So the cathode potential is equal to, is kept at zero for this diode. For this diode, cathode potential is kept at zero. This is zero. There is no current. So output is equal to zero. Now, whatever the anode potential is nothing but the input potential, just like this Vm sin omega t, the negative part. Now, what could have been the maximum value of this input signal? So this maximum value is nothing but this Vm. This Vm is the maximum, or I can say minus Vm. This is the maximum here, present over here. So anode potential is minus Vm. Cathode potential is zero. So what is the difference? That is minus Vm. So if I take the magnitude, it is only Vm. So for half-wave rectifier, you find that this peak inverse voltage for this particular diode operated under half-wave rectifier is equal to Vm. Same is true for this type of diode. You see that this type of diode, it is on under the reverse bias. I mean, during the negative half cycle, it is on. And during the positive half cycle, this diode is off. And during the positive half cycle, this output, I mean, the anode potential is equal to zero because output is zero. And cathode potential is this one. Cathode potential is this one during the positive half cycle. So during the positive half cycle, what happens is the maximum potential that can be applied at this cathode point is equal to plus Vm. The Vm sin omega t graph is like Vm sin omega t. So maximum potential will be Vm. So what will be the PIV here? So it is Vm. It's as simple as that. So what we can understand is that for half-wave rectifier, the peak inverse voltage for the diode is equal to Vm, where Vm sin omega t is the input signal. Now let us try to find out what is the peak inverse voltage for full wave rectifier and the bridge rectifier. And then we can make a comparative analysis that whether full wave rectifier is a better one, this bridge rectifier is a better one with respect to the or not. Now, before going into that calculation, now let us have a look of this half wave rectifier using the constant voltage model. So far we have assumed that the diodes are ideal. Now, if the diodes are ideal, so we have made two approximations. The first approximation is that the resistance of the diode, when the diode is on, there is no voltage drop across the diode. And second thing is that in order to make the diode on, I require, only the positive voltage, that is good enough. That means VT on is equal to zero. So last day we have discussed about the different types of model or different models of the diode. So for ideal diode, we have seen that when the anode to cathode potential VAK is just greater than zero, then the diode starts operating. But for constant voltage model, we have seen that VAK must be greater than some VD on in order to make the diode on. So that potential is equal to like 0.7 volt for silicon or 0.3 volt for germanium. And when the diode is on, during the entire duration, the voltage drop across the anode to cathode is equal to 0.7. That is like 0.7 volts. Right? Now, if I consider this constant voltage model, and we are going to apply this constant voltage model of diode in this particular half-wave rectifier circuit, then what happens, unlike the previous case, what you have seen that if the input voltage is just greater than zero, then the diode starts conducting. But here, we have to wait for VD. Here, VS is the input signal and VO is the output signal. So once again, VS by VO, as you know, this is the transfer characteristics. So until and unless VS is greater than or equal to VD, so diode will become off. So when VD, when the input signal just exceeds VD, then the diode will be on. And once the diode is on, what happens? I can write VS plus VD. Your VS is the input signal part. Your VD is the voltage drop across the diode, and V0 is equal to the output. So if I apply KVL, what you find? VS from this point to that point, this is VS. So here it is VD plus you have V0. So VS is equal to VD plus V0, right? So VS is equal to VD plus V0. So this is the equation of a straight line. So what will be the slope? Slope will be equal to 1. VS is equal to VD plus V0. VD is equal to constant, like some 0.7 volt or so. So it will be constant. And what happens when the input signal is less than VD? So diode will become off during the entire duration of operation. So from VD onwards up to minus infinity, it will become off. So as a matter of fact, so this is the transfer characteristics. Now let us have a look at the input output variation. How does it look like? The black line is for the input signal, Vs sine of omega naught t. Vm sine of omega naught t. So Vs being the input signal, instantaneous signal, and peak value is equal to say Vm. This one is Vm. Now, unlike the previous case, what we have seen that this is replicated. This black one is replicated for half wave. This black one is replicated for the half wave. But here you find that this is not the black one, rather the blue one. Why blue one? Because until and unless your input signal is higher than VD, the diode will not become on. So you have to wait at least up to VD. So when the input signal is equal to VD, then the diode starts operating. And then the diode is on and the voltage drop equal to VD. So what happens when the input signal reaches at its peak? Then your input value is equal to Vm. But what will be the output value here? You know that input value this minus this diode drop will be equal to the output value, because now we have to consider the diode drop as well. We are not considering that the diode is ideal. The diode is practical. I mean, the constant voltage model we are adopting. So this input value minus the diode drop is equal to your output value, V0. So if the input peak is equal to Vm and the diode drop that is constant always, that is VD. So Vm minus VD is equal to your output voltage. So this difference is equal to your VD, the diode drop. So accordingly, it gets modified, the output waveform for constant voltage model. Okay, now let us move to the second one. I mean, the constant voltage model for the full wave rectifier, the same kind of thing. Here you have seen that this is the black one. Form one is the VS and the dotted one is the minus VS. The same analogy I can apply. When the input signal is greater than VD, if the input signal is greater than VD, then only the diode D1 will conduct, and this one, and then this one, and then this one. So the odd half cycles are obtained at the output side. And when the input signal is less than minus VD, when VS is less than minus VD, then only this diode D2 will become off, will become on. And in that case, the current will flow through the diode D2 and RL. So during this time, from this point to that point, from this point to that, this point to that point, and so on. So there are two different benchmark points here. One is plus VD and one is minus VD. When input signal is greater than plus VD, then diode D1 will be on and the current will flow through the diode D1. And when the input signal is less than minus VD, then the diode D2 will become on and the current will flow through this diode. Now here you may argue that why slope is minus one here, because they have considered with respect to VS. Now with this, so this is with respect to minus VS. If you observe this one, So this potential they have considered like plus, and this is minus. So with respect to this, this is minus one. But during the negative half cycle, you know that this potential is always positive with respect to that potential. So that's why the polarity is just reversed. Now we are coming to that discussion where we have to appreciate that what is the value of this peak inverse voltage using your full wave rectifier using center tap transformer or full wave rectifier using bridge rectifier. Now let us see two different scenario here. One is the case, the first one where the turns ratio is 1:1, and the second one where the turns ratio is 1:2. Now let us have a look at the first one. So VP primary is input signal. So I'm assuming that VP primary is the peak value here. So VP primary to minus VP primary. So this is the input pattern. So I can write this input signal like VP primary into sine of omega naught t. Well, VP primary is nothing but the peak of the input signal. So there is a 1:1 turns ratio. So we expect that at the secondary winding, the signal that will be induced is like VP primary plus to minus, just like this. Now we have a center tap transformer here. So this center position is connected to ground. It's having a ground potential. So what is the voltage developed between this point and that point? What is the voltage developed between this point and that point? This is nothing but your input signal, V in, because here V in and V out being the same 1:1 turns ratio. So at any point of time, when input signal reaches here, VP primary at peak at this particular point, here also you can expect that difference between this point and that point, the anode of D1 and anode of D2. Their difference is also VP primary. If you see here, so VP primary by 2, this point to that point, and here VP primary by 2 with a negative sign. So plus VP primary by 2 and minus VP primary by 2. So what is the difference? This is VP primary by 2 minus of minus VP primary by 2. So this is only VP primary. Similarly here, what you find during the crest here at this particular point, this is minus VP primary. So this is minus VP primary by 2 minus of VP primary by 2. So minus of VP primary only. So just like this. So this is the input signal here from this point. I mean, this diagram or this particular waveform is the voltage developed, induced between this point, this anode of diode D1 and the ground. And this diagram is for the voltage developed between the anode of diode D2 and the ground. Now what happens if you observe this diagram? Now this particular waveform is supplied to the diode D1. So diode D1 will be on from this point to that point with a peak equal to VP primary by 2. And during the negative half cycle, it is off, as you understand, because here the diode will be reverse biased. Now what happens for this diode D2? For this diode D2, so this is drawn with respect to this particular potential, considering this to be ground. So this diode D2 is observing a negative fluctuation here. So obviously there will be no provision for current conduction for this particular diode during the positive half cycle. I mean, during this cycle, positive half cycle of the input, where the negative voltage is induced. And during the negative half cycle, what happens for this center tap transformer? This diode D2 sees a positive excursion. So diode D2 will be on, and this output will be developed like this, VP primary by 2. Now, apart from that, since we are dealing with constant voltage model, so the output is not like VP primary by 2 only. I mean, the peak of the output is not only VP primary by 2, rather it is VP primary by 2 minus 0.7 volt. Why minus 0.7 volt? Because this is a diode drop, VD, diode drop. So it will be minus 0.7 volt. Only one diode drop, because one of the diode will be conducting. Now, in order to make it a simpler one, so here you have considered the turns ratio to be 1:2. So if it is 1:2, then if it is like VP primary and minus VP primary being the input signal, so here the output side and the secondary side, you have VP primary 2 into VP primary. This will be the maximum excursion, or the peak will be at 2 VP primary. So following the same analogy, here you find that 0 to VP primary, 0 to minus VP primary, this is one thing which is developed between this point, between the diode D1, I mean the anode of the diode D1 and the ground. And this one, VP primary sine omega t, or rather minus VP primary sine omega t, will be developed, will be induced across here. So the same thing, the same waveform, only the difference, since the turns ratio has been increased from 1:1 to 1:2 here. So here you find that the peak has been increased from VP primary by 2 to VP primary only, and the same diode drop, that is 0.7 volt drop, is there for one diode only. So this is the operation. Now, considering this operation into our mind, now let us find out what is the peak inverse voltage for this type of diodes. Now, here we are considering that two defined signal. One is the VP primary, that is the input signal, and the second one is the VP secondary by VP secondary being the secondary output waveform. So what happens during the positive half cycle? We find that this diode D1 will be on. This diode D1 will be on during the positive half cycle. So if it conducts, then it is identified by this green color. So if it conducts, then VP secondary by 2 and VP secondary by 2 minus 0.7. At peak, the anode potential is at VP secondary by 2, and this potential is at VP secondary by 2 minus 0.7. So 0.7 volt drop is there. So diode is conducting. So there is a 0.7 volt drop only. Diode is conducting, and the output voltage developed is nothing but, so these two points are connected together. So output voltage is VP secondary by 2 minus 0.7 volt only. This happens when? This happens when you are at this particular point. This happens when you are at this particular point, at this point, when the input signal reaches at the positive peak.
Sir, can you please zoom into the PDF? People are having a hard time reading the notations.
Sorry?
Sir, can you zoom into the PDF that you, the part you are explaining? People are having a hard time reading the notations.
Notations, okay. Let me... Is it visible now in a clear way?
Yes, sir, quite visible.
I have increased the font size.
Yes, sir, it's visible.
Okay, fine, thank you. Okay, so now, at this particular point, what we find is VP secondary by 2 during the positive half cycle. This potential is at VP secondary by 2, this potential VP secondary by 2. And what about this potential? VP secondary by 2 minus 0.7 volt. So this diode is on. So voltage drop is like 0.7 volt. Diode is on. The output voltage is the same. VP secondary by 2 minus 0.7. So no problem with the diode D1 during the positive half cycle. Now what happens during the negative half cycle? What happens during the positive half cycle for the diode D2? You find that if VP primary by 2 is, let me go back to the previous slide once again. You see that if VP primary by 2 is present at the anode of diode D1, then minus VP primary by 2 is present at the diode D2, and vice versa. If VP primary by 2 positive is present at diode D1 at any time, then minus VP primary is present for diode D2, and vice versa. So for this diode, if VP secondary by 2 is present at this particular point, so minus VP secondary by 2 will be there for this diode, minus VP secondary by 2 at any instant. Now, the anode potential is equal to minus VP secondary by 2, anode potential. Anode potential is minus VP secondary by 2 for this diode. What is the cathode potential? Cathode potential being the same, this one, VP secondary by 2 minus 0.7, same one, because this is connected to, this is these two cathodes are connected together, tied together. So anode potential is minus VP secondary by 2, and the cathode potential is VP secondary by 2 minus 0.7, this potential. VP secondary by 2 minus 0.7 and this one. So what is the voltage developed, or what is the voltage available across the anode and cathode of the diode? If I calculate this one, what do you observe? We observe that PIV is nothing but VP secondary by 2 minus 0.7, this voltage, minus of minus VP secondary by 2. So here basically we are calculating VKA, cathode to anode, because we know that the resultant voltage will be negative because anode is having negative voltage with respect to cathode. So VAK will be negative. So that's why we are calculating VKA. So magnitude wise, VKA will be positive or VAK is negative. So what we got? VP secondary by 2 minus 0.7, the cathode potential minus of minus VP secondary by 2. So the difference is like VP secondary minus 0.7 volt. This is the difference. Now with respect to VP out, if I want to calculate what is VP out, VP out, we have seen that VP out is equal to VP secondary. VP out plus 1.4 volt, the simple calculation. And if I substitute the value of VP secondary over here in this PIV expression, we find that VPIV is equal to 2 VP out plus 0.7 volt. Now, if I consider ideal level, then this 0.7 volt drop will not be there. So in that case, you can find that PIV will become only 2 times of VP out. Whereas in case of your half-wave rectifier, we have seen that this PIV is coming like only VP out. Now let us have a look at the bridge rectifier. What is happening for bridge rectifier? So there they have considered two different models. One is the ideal model, second one is the practical model or the constant voltage model. So during the positive half cycle, you know that these two diodes identified by green, they will conduct during the positive half cycle because this one is having a higher potential with respect to this point. So diode D1 will be on. So there is no voltage drop considering the ideal diode, I mean ideal model of the diode. So this 0 volt drop is there. Then the current will flow from diode D through diode D1 through RL and D2 and back to the circuit. And during the positive half cycle, these diodes identified by this purple color or pink color, so they will be off, this D3 and D4. So while they are off, you expect that they are having some negative voltage across their anode to cathode terminal. Similarly, if I assume that the diode is like, if I assume that the diode is having a constant voltage model, if I assume that particular model to be effective, then the drop is like 0.7 volt for this diode D1 and D3 when they are on. And during the negative half cycle, what happens? This diode D2 and D4, they will be on, and D1 and D3, they will be off. Now, how to find out the PIV for each of these two cases? Let us have a look. How to calculate the PIV for each of these two cases. For ideal diode, what is happening? VP secondary is the voltage developed at the secondary winding of this transformer. Okay, now what you find is VP out is same as VP secondary for ideal diode because there is zero volt drop. So VP secondary and VP out, they are same. So let us look at this diode D3. Let us look at this diode D3. Anode potential is how much? Anode potential is equal to zero because it is connected to ground. What is the cathode potential? Cathode potential is nothing but VP secondary, and which is equal to VP out because those two are same. So what is the PIV, peak inverse voltage for this diode D3? This is nothing but VP secondary or VP out. Now let us consider the constant voltage model. What you are getting for constant voltage model? For constant voltage model, the anode potential of the diode D3 is equal to zero. Is equal to zero. This is connected to ground. What about the cathode potential? Cathode potential is how much? This potential is how much? How to calculate this potential? This potential minus 0.7 is equal to your VP out. This potential minus 0.7 is equal to VP out. So this potential will be VP out plus 0.7. This potential will be VP out plus 0.7. So VP out plus 0.7. is the cathode potential, and what is the anode potential? That is zero. Then what is the drop, or what is the voltage developed across this diode? This is only VP out plus 0.7, unlike 2 VP out plus 0.7. So what we have seen for full wave rectifier involving semiconductor transformer, the peak inverse voltage was like 2 VP out plus 0.7, 2 VP out plus 0.7 for semiconductor transformer, and for bridge rectifier, we have seen that it is like only VP out plus 0.7. And if I consider ideal diode model, in that case 0.7 drop will not be there. So only VP out. So I believe that you understand how to get this VP out and how to get this 2 VP out for bridge rectifier and center transformer. But the thing is that why should we prefer this peak inverse voltage as an important parameter? Now let us think that having a diode for which the breakdown voltage is fixed at, say, for example, at say 20 volt. That's a 20 volt, right? Now, what we find is for center-tuned transformer, the peak inverse voltage is equal to 2 VP out. So, in order to ensure that this peak inverse voltage is well within the breakdown voltage of the diode, I have to ensure that this 2 VP out, that is the peak inverse voltage, must be less than the breakdown voltage so that the diode is not damaged. So if the peak inverse voltage of the diode, or rather the breakdown voltage of the diode, is fixed at say 20 volt, so what I can do at most is 2 VP out is equal to 20 volt. So from that I can have VP out is equal to 10 volt. So this is the scenario for center-tuned transformer case. Now let us have a look at the bridge rectifier case. For bridge rectifier case, we have seen that peak inverse voltage is equal to VP out only. If I just neglect the 0.7 drop right now, so PIV is equal to only VP out, then this PIV cannot exceed the breakdown voltage. What is the breakdown voltage here? Breakdown voltage here is equal to, for example, 20 volt. So VPIV is equal to 20 volt is equal to VP out. So here we find that VP out is equal to 20 volt at max. So for bridge rectifier, at max I can have VP out is equal to 20 volt, whereas if I use the same diode, same type of diode having a breakdown voltage of 20 volt, I can have VP out is equal to 10 volt. That means if I use a particular diode whose breakdown voltage is fixed at 20 volt, then this diode can be used to rectify any alternating input signal, I mean any sinusoidal signal of having a maximum voltage of 10 volt for center-tuned transformer case, and it can rectify any signal up to 20 volt for bridge rectifier case. Or in other words, if I have a 10 sine omega naught t kind of thing input signal, and if I apply this to a center-tuned transformer kind of thing with a diode having a breakdown voltage of 20 volt, then it can be operated nicely. But anything greater than 10 sine omega naught t, if I provide 12 sine omega naught t or 15 sine omega naught t or 15 sine omega naught t, and diode is having a breakdown voltage of 20 volt, then obviously this diode will be damaged, because the peak inverse voltage, you find that it will be higher than the breakdown voltage. The diode will get damaged. So I have to use at max 10 sine omega naught t for center-tuned transformer. But for bridge rectifier circuit, you can use up to 20 sine omega naught t. So for higher voltage application, this bridge rectifier is applicable, or this can be used without hampering the diode operation or without damaging the diode. So this is the biggest advantage that we are getting with respect to this peak inverse voltage for your bridge rectifier. Now, even it is a bridge rectifier or center-tuned transformer involving, full wave rectifier involving center-tuned transformer, you'll see that the output signal is not a constant one. What we have tried initially in the second slide of this lecture, I have told you that our objective is to make the signal a constant one, a DC one, DC to DC conversion. This is known as a rectification. This constant value we are not getting. Rather, we find that there is a fluctuation of the input signal. And somehow, if I move from half-wave rectifier to full-wave rectifier, somehow I can reduce the ripple, I can increase the smoothness. That is also validated by the value of form factor and the ripple factor. But still, if I want to smooth it further, then I have to use a particular circuit, which is known as the filter circuit. This filter circuit will eliminate the redundant information, will eliminate the external ripple signal that is present within the signal by means of its own operation. Now, what is that filter circuit? So this is done by means of a simple capacitor connected in shunt with the load resistance RL. Now, what happens here? They have considered the ideal. This is not ideal. This one is for the constant voltage model. So the diode drop is VD on. This is a diode drop. VD on is a diode drop. So Vin is the input signal. So you know that until and unless the input signal goes beyond VT on, so that this diode will not be on. So once it is on, so during the positive half cycle up to the peak, the diode is on. it is acting as a closed switch, and the connection is established, and at the same time this capacitor is getting charged up to this point Vm, which is equal to Vp minus Vd on. Up to this point the capacitor gets charged. What happens then, if I assume that capacitor can retain the charge, then beyond this point, beyond this peak, beyond T1, what happens? The anode potential of the diode starts decreasing, because you have a Vm sin omega t kind of thing. Vm is the peak, and after T1, after this pi by 2, you know that the output thing, I mean input signal will be reduced. So now for the diode D1, or for this particular diode, you find that the cathode potential is fixed at Vp minus Vd on, whereas the anode potential is now reducing. You know that the voltage across the capacitor cannot be changed instantaneously. So the capacitor voltage or the cathode potential of the diode is kept at Vb minus Vd on, whereas the anode potential starts decreasing. And what happens? Then the diode will become off. Diode will become off. Now the capacitor is having some charge. Now this resistance RL is there. Now capacitor starts discharging with the within this circuit, this RL C1 circuit. So capacitor starts discharging, and the waveform, okay, I'll be coming to the waveform, how you are getting this waveform later on, but the capacitor will discharge. There is no doubt about that, the capacitor will discharge, although it will follow an exponential kind of nature, but assuming that it is a linear fault, so capacitor will start discharging like this. And once again, when the capacitor this potential is higher than this input potential, then once again the diode becomes on, and the once again the capacitor will be charged up to this Vp minus Vd on. And in this way you are having a signal for which the ripple component is a bit less as compared to the signal without this filter circuit. Now there they have considered two different models of the diode. So during the time when the capacitor is charged, this switch is closed. This switch is closed, and it is represented by means of a battery, because a constant voltage model we are using. So if I don't use the constant voltage model, so in that case this switch is on, but this battery will not be there, because you have a zero volt drop obviously, and the capacitor is there and the resistance is there. So accordingly the your circuit, I mean the current flow or the voltage pattern, the V out, will look something like that. Now what happens beyond T1? Beyond T1, you know that this diode, because anode potential is less now with respect to the cathode potential beyond T1. So now the diode, this particular diode, will become off. So the switch will be open, and the capacitor, this is the combination, CR combination, and the charge that is written over here, the capacitor starts discharging with this, by means of this particular circuit, this RLC1 combination. And there is a mistake in this diagram. They have shown that this is VR. This is not actually the VR. VR is this one. This potential, this line, Vp minus Vd on, this line and this line, the maximum output and the and this compo, this point. So this is the VR, the ripple voltage. Now how can you reduce the ripple voltage? Now this particular slide shows you the effect of the capacitor. So they have considered three different values of the capacitor: very very small capacitor C1, small capacitor, and a large capacitor. So if the value of the capacitance is very small, in that case it cannot retain charge, and you find that the voltage developed across this will be something like that. It will discharge very quickly. If you have small or moderate value of C1, then it will be something like that, and if it is very large, in that case capacitor can retain the charge to some extent, and the ripple component will be less. So this is the analytical expression or analytical observation for the effect of the capacitor. Now let us have a look at the mathematical model or mathematical expression. So it's nothing like, I mean, this Vout, that expression for any RC circuit. If you have an RC circuit excited by means of one input signal having a value equal to Vp minus Vd on, so how does it look like when RC circuit, when the input signal is like a signal like Vx, and initially suppose the signal is, I mean the inter capacitor is charged to Vx, then what happens with respect to time? You find that the voltage across the capacitor starts discharging, and using that particular equation, the equation is like Vx exponential minus t by RLC1. So if you follow your classes on circuit theory, you understand that this is a very fundamental one or very obvious one, this particular expression, V out is equal to some Vx into exponential minus T by RC, minus T by RC. So at T is equal to zero, at this particular point, the capacitor voltage, the output voltage will be equal to Vx, because exponential minus T by RC, so T is equal to zero, this expression will become one, exponential zero is one, so it will be like Vx. And as the time progresses, you find that there is an exponential decay, and ideally, when T is equal to infinite, in that case, the output will become zero. But once again, the fall is very much dependent or controlled by the value of this RL and C1 combination, which is known as the RC time constant for this circuit. Now, let us move to the second line of the expression. So I can write this Vp minus Vd on. So here, Vx equal to Vp minus Vd on. Why? Because the initial value with which the capacitor was charged, let's go to the previous slide, this slide. The initial value with which the capacitor was charged was like Vp minus Vd on, and then it starts discharging. So this is the initial value. So Vx is equal to Vp minus Vd on. So Vx into e to the power minus T by RC, what I can write. So here R is equal to RL and C is equal to C1. It's something like that. Now, in this particular equation, e to the power minus T by RC, you know, that can be written approximately to 1 minus T by RC, as I was mentioning last day, that e to the power expression, e to the power x is equal to 1 plus x square factorial 2 and so on. Now I can eliminate those x square, x cube, x to the power 4 and higher order terms if and only if this T by RLC, that particular thing is very, very small. Now how to ensure that T by RLC is very small? That the value of this RLC1, this combination, RLC1, this product is, if this value is much, much larger with respect to the time period of the input signal, if the time period of the input signal is like T in, and with respect to T in, if this RLC1 is very, very large, in that case, T by RLC1, that ratio is very small, then exponential minus T by RLC1 or exponential minus X can be written like 1 minus X only, if I neglect the higher order terms. So it will be like Vp minus Vd on, and then minus of Vp minus Vd on by RL into T by C1. Then what is the, how to find out the ripple component? So this is the V out T expression. So you know that V out T expression is this one. This is the expression for this. This is the expression for this waveform. Expression for this waveform. How to find out the ripple component? So as I have already mentioned, ripple component is nothing but this, the difference between this point and this point. So this is the difference. So what is that value? This is Vp minus Vt on. And as you have seen already, if RLC1 time constant is large enough with respect to the time period of the signal, so this is the time period from T1 to T3, this is the time period of the signal. So with respect to T1 to T3, if this RLC1 is pretty large, so in that case, exponential decaying can be replaced by a linear kind of decaying, right? So this will be something like that. So e to the power minus T by RLC1 is like 1 minus T by RLC1 kind of thing. And how to find out the ripple? So ripple is this value minus this value. So how to find out this value? You have already got the expression for this waveform from that discharge equation, and put the value at T is equal to T in. If I put the value T is equal to T in, this is the time duration. If I start from this point, suppose this is the zero point, and after this point, so T3 minus T1 is equal to the input time period. T3 minus T1 is the input time period approximately. So if this is equal to your zero, so with respect to that, the time difference is equal to T in. Now, if I put the value T in here, in this expression, if I put the value of T in, so T in into Vp minus Vd on by RL into C1. So how to find out the difference? So difference is nothing but this Vp minus Vd on minus this V out T. So Vp minus Vd on gets canceled. Vp minus Vd on gets canceled. So you have Vp minus Vd on minus Vp minus Vd on plus Vp minus Vd on into T by RLC1. So after calculation, you find that the ripple component is equal to Vp minus Vd on by RL into T in by C1. And I can represent this T in by 1 by F in, which is the input frequency. So Vp minus Vd on by RL C1 into F in. So that is the expression for a ripple component present. So just by observing this, you can appreciate that ripple component can be reduced if I increase the value of RLC1, that means if I increase this RLC1 component value of, that means the time constant of this RC circuit. So if the value of C1 or the capacitor is large, then obviously it will discharge little. So in that case, the ripple component will be less, or ripple count will be less. And apart from that, you can also increase the value of RL as well. That is the load resistance. And in terms of Vin, in terms of Fin, I can give you one hint that for although this circuit was shown for half wave rectifier, but you know, for full wave rectifier, the Fin value or the input waveform will, I mean, the input frequency will be double for full wave rectifier. If the input signal is having a frequency of 50 hertz, then for half wave rectifier, the output will be 50 hertz frequency. But for full wave rectifier, the output will be 100 hertz frequency. So if I increase the Fin also, that means the your frequency of operation of the output signal, then also the ripple component would have been reduced to some extent. So this is the decaying part of the exponential, the ripple amplitude. And to some extent, it will create some problem if it goes above 5 to 10% of the output voltage. So in that case, we cannot use this as a very good filter circuit. So in that case, apart from the simple RC filter, you have to go for some other filter circuit so that the ripple components could have been reduced to some extent. And you can have almost ripple-free kind of thing, almost constant kind of waveform, so that this can be applied to the further circuits, further electronic circuits for several applications. So with this, I believe that today's lecture, I mean, the presentation is completed. Now, if you have any